Welcome everybody. You're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today we're using Sklearn to do some one-hot and label encoding one and multiple columns. Let's look at what our data consists of. The original data set will be country, device, and version number. It's just dummy data that I created. And the end result should look something like this, where we have our label encoding for the version and country, as well as one-hot for the devices. Before we get into this, I would like to say thank you to the new subscribers and viewers recently. I greatly appreciate it. For the label encoding, let's start with doing one column at a time. The second example will be doing multiple columns at once. So we're going to do the countries first and then the version number. And this is what the result will look like. So let's create our label encoder. I will call this label encoder as our variable name. Take in the label encoder. Let's call the label encoder. And we have to do a fifth transform and call in our data, which would be the df country. And here's what it looks like. But let's actually store this as a new column for our data frame. And let's call it country label encoder. See what that looks like. So here's what we look like for the label encoding of our country. Let's move on to the next one, where we're going to do the same thing, except this will be for the version. Let's print that out. Now we got the first two columns, so that's looking promising. Let's investigate these data real quick. So what's going on with this? So it looks like from our version labels here, it looks like it's encoding the number 2 label as 12.4, the first label as 10.3, or the zero label, I should say, first one as 3.4. But if you notice here, this is looking kind of strange because this is 7, this is 5, this is 6. And you have to consider a few things of how this is actually ordering these. It's calling in the 1, and then it's doing any comparison from 1 to the other 1. The first digit, it's not looking at this as a 10. Then it would proceed and look at if 1 and 1 are tied, look at the second position. If these are tied, look at this third position. If that's tied, look at these positions right here. And that's how that's working. Let's do some reverse encoding. So for instance, if this was your label encoding this particular version number, we can do something here where we go basically backwards from our encoding. So we can look at our label encoder and do the same thing that we did before. Let's just call in the version and only take the first 5 entries. And then we're going to call the label encoder, but we're going to now do an inverse transform so we can get back all of our information. Let's just cut and paste that. And then let's take the first 5 entries and do a comparison. There we are. And let's get our first 5 entries and do that comparison. So it's looking like we're able to convert it back from our labels. So this would be the labels for the first 5 entries. And this is the actual entries that we encoded. So that's what it looks like. And you can do a comparison here to see how they match up if you're skeptical or if you're just verifying that this was actually doing what you thought it was doing. So we can go forwards and backwards, but we need to do some considerations, all right? So let's think about this in terms of ordinal data where you have some form of ordering. So you may have a label that corresponds to actual ordered data, which is kind of a concern. So let's assume that the version, instead of doing this as a label, what if it actually had some form of ordering? So in the circumstance of these data, instead of doing label encoding, we have to account for an order, okay? And because of that, you also have another thing that you need to bear in mind, which is right here. There are circumstances where you have to switch encoding methods. For instance, if you do label encoding and your data did not have some form of ordering and your algorithm thinks that your labels now have some form of ordering, you may need to also convert that into further one-hot encoding and expand that as a matrix. So that's two different things that you need to think about. So let's look at this real quick. If I was just comparing these not as strings, but as numeric literals, where we have an underscore separating this, can we do a comparison? And this comparison looks like it's printing off correctly. But then you have an issue. This 12 is actually bigger than this 10. But you have an issue because it's saying that this 10 is bigger than this 12. And then if we skip down to this one, we see that this 10 is actually looking like it's smaller than this 9, which is interesting because it's actually reading this string as this 1 versus this 9 because it does not have a second number behind it. So it's only comparing this with this instead of the 10. Okay, now we have this printing out correctly because you're able to go through and match all of these sequentially, and it finally does a comparison of the 1 versus the 2. So if we're dealing with the ordinal data, we need to figure out how we can actually map this correctly. So you would think that converting these into integers would work, right? And you would think, okay, this looks like it's promising. This looks like something that I could actually use, okay, for ranking. So how would we deal with this if we're doing, should we do some one hot encoding first? How should we deal with this? Let's get into that at the end. First, let's get into one hot encoding.
Just call this one hot ENC for encoding. And let's call in our encoder. And let's do something called handle unknown equals ignore. The description is above right here, so you can read that while I'm typing this in. So let's create a data frame and take in what we're calling right above. And we're going to do a fit transform as usual. And what are we calling in? We're going to take in the devices now, since that was only iPad. And so what does this look like? iPad and your iPhone. So here's what we look like. Okay, not very interesting. It looks like it's just creating two separate columns. This seems kind of nonsense, but it's actually relevant. In the case that you have many variables that you're mapping, it'll spread this out into many columns that can be formed into a matrix, which is pretty useful. So let's join these data together in order to see what it actually looks like. So there we go. So now we have a one hot encoded devices. Sure, that seems useful. Let's look at inversing this to make sure that everything works correctly. So we can always print everything off so we can do a comparison. And we want to take in this. So let's take this in. So let's cut and paste this and put it in. And let's take the first five values. Then let's create something called encode where we're going to do our fit transform, and then we're going to call in our data frame with our devices. And then how do we deal with this now? We can do a inverse transform of the data that we just encoded. And let's take the first five entries. And there you go. So you can see that you have your iPhone, you have your iPad, iPhone, iPad. So it changes, all right? Here, the second entry of these tuples, all right? So that looks fine and dandy. We can now multi-encode, taking in as many columns as you have for your data that's able to get encoded. But we need to now isolate some of our columns since we've been manipulating our data and doing some encoding. So we're only taking the last three, so we can look at that real quick. So we're only taking these because if I did the whole thing, you can see that we have our encoding. Let's call this encoding all columns, where we need our new isolated data frame. And we're going to use an apply function, allowing us to take in the label encoder. And we're going to do a fit transform as usual. And what's this look like? Okay, cool. So we got back our encoding. Now let's take that encoding and rename these columns. So let's create a new variable and let's just say df encoding. It's going to be the data frame with the encoding. And we need to concatenate our data frame that we just isolated and what we just used. But we need to pay attention to the axis that we're working with. And let's print this off. If I pay attention. Let's print this off. So we worked out taking in as the label, it was able to read each one of these and encode them, and the binary or one hot was taken care of by itself. So that's perfect. And I guess there's a distinction by calling this binary encoding versus this create your array, your NumPy array. Now what else can we do? Let's do a second example of this to see how it works. But let's do this a little bit different. So let's call in our collections. module and import a default dictionary. Let's name this D. Run an apply function where we're going to call in our lambda, create our dictionary where we're taking the name of our variable, and then we're going to do a transform on this variable. If I paid attention. Oh. And I'm not paying attention because we need to call in the label encoder within our dictionary so we can actually use this apply function. So here we are. We're able to use a different method where we call in a default dictionary. And here, if you've ever used these, you can use a list where you basically append for your keys, all your values would be lists. But in this case, you're taking in your values as your label encoding, which works perfectly. We can make this a little more appropriate. Do an inverse of the same thing, but this is going to be a little bit different. So let's do a apply function on our fit, and we're going to do very similar to here. But we're going to take in an inverse of this now. And let's see what this looks like. And there we go. We got everything back. So we can go forwards and backwards. And lastly, since we're dealing with that ordinal data for our version, if we were considering it not as just a labeling, but actual ordering, we should deal with that now. If we were to say that these were strings of numeric literals separated by underscores, let's figure out how we can actually encode this. And it's not too bad. All we have to do is just iterate within our data frame for the version that we're dealing with. And then we're going to make a temporary variable, taking in our label encoder, doing our fit transform, and we need to do something interesting. So let's see what happens if we convert this into an integer. And let's also create a separate temporary variable. And let's take in our label encoder again. And let's instead call in the data frame column. And let's print everything out and see what happens. Okay, so there's a lot going on here. So this first one right here is what happens when we're label encoding the values as integers. So if we were to take this and consider it an integer, this is how these would look like for the first five entries. Okay, then if we were doing a comparison of these strings, we mentioned before that it says this is not bigger than this, but we're taking it as an integer that we just did. And you say, well, this doesn't look really good. The original data that we took in doing the transform is this one, which is represented here. And you'll see the difference in encoding numbers. And what happens is it's printing off this. This is getting printed off if we're doing a comparison of taking those numbers as integers. But notice this right here. Where'd the zero come in? That didn't come in right here. There's no zero. But what it's doing is, it's replacing this, okay? But that doesn't work. That's not really what we need. So it's replacing these first underscores with zeros. So this is close, but it's not quite correct. So we need to do some further investigation. So I wanted to do a number literal conversion and look into this, because if we do this as a comparison of a float instead, what happens? So as a float, you still have this issue where it does that conversion of that first underscore into a zero, but we need to then refine it. So what I decided to do is first iterate through each one of our versions here, each one of those independently, and replace each underscore with a dot, so making it into a float, and only taking the first occurrence of it. The second or subsequent occurrences of this will be replaced instead of an underscore with an empty space. And that's what you end up with here. So then now we have actual ordering and it's correct, all right? So you can take this and use it as ordinal data now, which is what you want if you're not considering this just as a plain label. Now, I would like to say further work that can be done with this would be looking into memory management if you have a larger data set for label encoding, because there's tricks or different types of label encoding you can do to make sparse matrices, to cut down on the amount of space you're using if you had hundreds or even thousands of variables to do comparisons against, which starts making an explosion of your matrix if you had one, and slows down the computational time of reading in and evaluating everything. Now, I would like to say that I took in these data and I looked at how these are reading in and comparing it to its actual label. So if you notice, here's all of the labels on the first or the zero index of each tuple. Here's its actual value that I converted it to. And you notice that it's correct if you're comparing it here to the label number that's printed off corresponding to its actual value. So you could see that you can actually label and code this correctly now. Lastly, I put everything together so you can see what it looks like from your version of label encoding and as a final installment versus the label encoding version of the string literal. And I also concatenated the actual float values that we have so you can see what this looks like as a whole. But I'd like to say thank you for watching. Please like, share, and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. As always, I hope this brought utility to someone. Thank you for watching. See you in the next video. Bye.